good.
All right, if everyone could begin to take their seats, that would be great. We have a jam-packed evening before us. And they have redirected that light to the point that I can't see you, which is disconcerting. I'm Angie Dodson. I'm the Director of Learning and Engagement here at Hillwood, and it's my distinct pleasure on behalf of our Executive Director, Kate Markert, our board, and our staff to welcome you all to the museum this evening. On my paper here, I have written that it's a pleasure to see so many faces, though I'm really struggling to see a one of you. But before the lights went down and this one came on oh so brightly, I did recognize a few very familiar faces and then some new ones as well. So we're very pleased to have you all with us this evening. We are gathered here together to explore some of the themes related to our current exhibition, Friends in Fashion, An American Diplomat in 1820s Russia. This exhibition will be open until June, and I encourage all of you to come back again and again. If you come back in a couple of weeks, you'll see tulips in addition to the lovely Russian art. And then a couple weeks after that, azaleas, and so on and so forth, all the way through the exhibition's run. We want you to keep up with what's going on here at Hillwood, and to that end, we encourage you to give us your email information. We promise that we will be judicious in sending you information, but if that is something that's of interest to you, please do leave your information at the desk. Alternatively, sign up with us on Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram. It is our way of making sure you know what's going on and you know before the general public does. You can see by our sort of close quarters this evening that seating is often limited at our programs. So sometimes learning early is really the best way to make sure that you can be with us. Before I say any other words, and I just have just a few more words, I do want to encourage you all to silence whatever devices you have in your pockets or pocketbooks. And with that, I will say how good. I made the mistake of not turning mine off in a meeting early this morning, and I have a very embarrassing ring, so it was not good. We are so pleased to be working with Anton Fedyashin and AU's Carmel Institute for Russian Culture and History for the fourth time. I was just saying to Anton how I remember very vividly our first program together and how wonderful a memory it continues to be in my mind. What we're going to do this evening is to, I'm going to just get us kicked off. Anton will follow with some remarks that set the exhibition into the context of the proper political and just straight history. I will return to the stage and just make a few remarks about the exhibition and some of the ideas that we organized around in creating it. And then that will lead nicely into Polly Blakesley's presentation on portraiture, which I could not be more pleased that we have this opportunity this evening to do a deep dive there, because that's not something we were really able to do in any great detail in the exhibition. After that, all of us will return to the stage and we will engage in a round of any questions that you have about anything that has been said or anything that might happen to be on your minds. Anton is going to have to leave us, and in his stead is Eric Lohr, also from AU, who will moderate that session. After we get finished in this room, we're going to have Polly signing her book. The exhibition will be open out in the dacha, and I promise you I would rather talk to you about it there than here, so please join me and my fellow curators out in the dacha, and then after that, for the AU students, the mansion will be open for touring. So that's sort of the lay of the land. I will hush, our evening is packed, and I will simply welcome Anton to the stage.
Boy, well, evening, everyone. This is blinding, this is great.
First of all, thank you to the Hillwood Museum. This is the fourth year. My colleague and nowadays my boss, who is the head of the history department, Dr. Eric Lohr, is here with us. He'll be doing the moderating. My job tonight is to give you a crash course in history. But before your eyes glaze over, don't worry. We'll go fairly fast. And the historical political context, because without this, of course, it's very, very difficult to understand the history of art and the reasons for which things appear are heard the way they are. And so we're going to work a little bit with maps and a lot with images, specifically architecture. I'm on the kick, so we're going to be doing neoclassicism. But the story of the Middleton's presence in Russia during the 1820s, a time of instability and stability at the same time, were preceded by one of the most destabilizing events in European history, the beginning of the so-called long 19th century, the events in France, of course, in the very end of the 18th century, the French Revolution, the very late 1780s and the 1790s. And remember, by the end of the 1790s, the French Revolution really sort of evolves into a long series of wars of expansion or conquest. They are often referred to as the French Revolutionary Wars. There's usually a period that's referred to specifically as the Napoleonic Wars, that are sort of nested one in the other. But as a whole, looking back in retrospect, it is one long series of over 20 years of incessant conflict. And so by the 1800s, as Napoleon's armies are revolutionizing warfare and doing it with head-spinning success, Europe really does descend into what is an unprecedented amount of violence. The 20th century, we now know, outdoes anything that the 19th century produced. But in the early 19th century, if you were alive in Central Europe with armies and whole nations moving back and forth, this was a completely new experience. It's not to say that war was new to Europe, but certainly wasn't. But the scale, the rapidity, and the persistence of war by the early 1800s really was something that was completely new. And the real turn of events, as far as we're concerned, with Middleton, Russia, and the United States, came in 1806 and was really unrelated to the United States directly, or really even to Russia, because it's in 1806 that the British end up imposing an embargo on France, and the French respond to this, Napoleon's government responds to this, with what becomes known as the Continental System. The French attempt to blockade all of the ports in Europe in order to prevent the British from trading with the continent. The Russians, after the Peace of Tilsit in 1807, are forced into the Continental System, and it's in that context that in 1809, diplomatic relations are established between Russia and the United States for the first time in history. The first ambassador of the United States to Russia is none other than John Quincy Adams, who will become the sixth president of the United States less than two decades later. And it's John Quincy Adams who does the breaking of the ice. The United States is important for Russia as a trading partner. It's a way to outmaneuver the Continental System and the British mind, and it will get the Brits and the United States into trouble by 1812. But by 1812, Napoleon gets himself into trouble first by invading Russia, something that he had been warned against doing. But in June of 1812, the famous invasion takes place. You see the route that the French armies take, Borodino, which happens in the Battle of Borodino, which happens in September of 1812, is the bloodiest battle of the war up to that date. There'll be bigger ones a little bit later. And the United States and Russia remarkably find themselves on opposite sides of the conflict in relation to Great Britain, because in 1812, of course, the United States fights the British here on on American soil, including in Washington, D.C. You probably know about the burning of the White House. In 1812, the Russians and the Brits are fighting on the same side against Napoleon. But it's then that Tsar Alexander I of Russia offers to mediate between the Brits and the Americans. And of course, there's an ulterior purpose to this, as there always is in high international politics. The Russians want to make sure that the Americans stay their friends, because they want to dilute the British presence in the Baltic, thinking ahead of what will come at the end of the wars. I wanted to show you a very curious map, which some of you who are history buffs probably know. In the 1860s, a French engineer by the name of Pierre-Joseph Minard put together a map of the size of Napoleon's army on the way into Russia. That's the sand-colored graph to the left, all the way to Moscow, and the size of the army during its retreat. And it makes you appreciate the enormous loss of life that Napoleon sustained as a result of this campaign. And by 1814, the Russians and their European allies end up chasing Napoleon's armies all the way to Paris. In the middle of the city, in the spring of 1814, Tsar Alexander I, the autocrat of Russia, presides over what must have seemed like a surreal ceremony to many Europeans. He atones for the sins of the French Revolution before the peoples of Europe, Parisians first and foremost, because the view at the time was that the liberal leftist excesses of the 1780s and especially the 1790s had naturally given birth to the excesses of the Napoleonic era. And it's in 1814, 1815, and the reason why I'm dwelling on all of this, that Europe enters a period of enforced stability. The chaos of the French Revolution and what people saw as its natural outcome, the expansionism of France and the violence under Napoleon, lead to this thirst for peace and for stability. And in Europe, this came in the form of the first major international sort of agreements as to how to control peace on the continent. And interestingly enough, in architecture, in St. Petersburg, the town where the Middletons will find themselves in 1820, this search for stability took on visual forms. Neoclassicism, which was not a style of architecture that was invented in the 19th century, it had come to Russia from Europe during the late 1800s, during Catherine the Great's reign, the second half of the 18th century, became the symbol of stability and order. And when you start looking at buildings in St. Petersburg that the Middletons saw, for example, the Stock Exchange, which is completed just a few years after the war, Carlo Rossi becomes the architect's name associated with stability. And this kind of Euclidean angularity, the proportions of the neoclassical age, everything is created to project the image of stability and order. And Russia becomes the symbol of this stability and order coming on the coattails of the chaos of the French Revolutionary era and of the Napoleonic Wars. Another example, the Admiralty Building, which is completed in 1823. It's the one with the white columns and the golden spire that you can see from most of the avenues that run towards the center of St. Petersburg. Also a symbol of stability. Notice, by the way, the color schemes. It becomes very popular in the 18-teens, 1820s. Something inherited from the late 18th century, the neoclassicism of that period, to paint the buildings these pastel yellow and white colors. This kind of simplicity also bleeds into fashion. And when you compare the fashions of the 18th century and the wigs for the men, the powdering of the faces, and those crazy coiffures for the women, Marie Antoinette was particularly singled out for often unjust criticism, you see the difference. You'll see plenty of those pictures in Rosalind's presentation. The Mikhailovsky Palace, which is today the Russian Museum in St. Petersburg, is another example of neoclassical architecture. Neoclassicism in the 18-teens and 1820s was the language of conservatism. It became the language of empire, of order, of predictability, of stability and prosperity in Europe, but at the cost of liberal revolutions. In Moscow, it was Osip, as the Russians call him, Joseph Bover, who became the poster child of neoclassicism. The Manezh building is one of the perfect examples, completed in 1817. The original title of it, by the way, was the Exerzierhaus, the house for the guards to practice their maneuvers during bad weather. So the military aspect of the preservation of order became very important as we approach the 1820s. Last one I'll show you from Moscow, Bavier's design for the Bolshoi Theater. The building is redone later in the 19th century on the outside, but not terribly different from the original structure. What's remarkable about the United States and Russia in the 18-teens and 1820s is that they share a sense of manifest destiny, for lack of a better word, in the case of Russia. In the Russian case, in the European case, however, stability and the struggle for stability comes in the form of struggling against nationalistic liberal regimes. And it's very interesting to remember that in the beginning of the 19th century, liberalism is a liberal cause. It's at the end of the 19th century that patriotism is a liberal cause. It's at the end of the 19th century that patriotism becomes a conservative cause, a cause that sparks violence, and it will get Europe into all sorts of trouble by 1914. But in the early 19th century, it's liberals in Italy, in France, in Spain, in Russia itself that took up the cause of nationalism, because back then the nation was opposed to the crown. And it's into this world of projected stability and the brewing instability in Europe that the Middletons end up in Russia. To this day, by the way, Middleton holds the record for the longest ambassadorship, American ambassadorship, to Russia. And as you'll read in the exhibit, he is chosen because of his wealth. It took money to live on the level of the Russian court. He's chosen because he's expected to negotiate a treaty with the British about returning slaves. And he's from South Carolina, and a man with a distinguished background and a very worldly education, an internationalist of the American sort. He finds St. Petersburg very welcoming. He makes a good home there, as opposed to John Quincy Adams, by the way, whose New England frugality did not really go over well in St. Petersburg under Alexander I. He was often looked down upon as stingy, although that is not what the Adams family was. But the life of the elite in the capital was the life of eye-popping wealth. And you can read about this in Tolstoy's War and Peace, among many, many other books. The world beyond Russia in the 1820s, just as the Middletons arrive, is descending into instability again, because it's in the 1820s that a wave of revolutions will roll across Europe, in Naples, in Spain, as you can tell by this map, in the Kingdom of Piedmont, Sardinia. Liberal revolts will try to shake up the system. And Russia emerges, along with Prussia and Austria-Hungary, as one of the three members of the Holy Alliance, the first example of an international peacekeeping organization, as they saw it back then, as guarantors of stability in Europe. This attempt to impose stability came at the price of liberalism, of constitutional reforms. And it's under Alexander I, right after his death, as a matter of fact, that this wave of liberal revolutions rolls all the way back to St. Petersburg, where in December of 1825, the Decembrists, as they are known for obvious reasons, the month, end up organizing a failed revolt to try to impose a constitution on Russia. And it's these events, this instability in Europe, this attempt to impose order, that really characterizes diplomatic relations. Between Russia and the US, the 1820s unfold under the remarkable spirit of trade. As a matter of fact, most of the 19th century, until the upheavals of the Russian revolutions in the 19-teens, in U.S.-Russian relations, are fairly boring to read about in the best possible sense, because there are no extreme highs, there are no extreme lows. It's a very functional relationship based on trade, which booms throughout the 1820s and the 1830s. By the 1820s, when the Middletons are in Russia, about 30% of Russian imports comes on American ships. Some of the biggest ones are sent to trade through the Baltic. I'll leave you with two examples of buildings that are constructed while the Middletons are in Russia. The General Staff Building, the one with the big arch, here's the Winter Palace on the bottom, is completed by the early 1830s, and it shows the importance of the army, of order, once again neoclassical Euclidean straight lines. This is the symbol of power. Architecture has always been a language of power, of projecting power, and St. Petersburg, as one of the major European capitals, was no exception. The finance and the foreign ministries will also share the building with the general staff. Today, the left part of the building has been renovated to house some of the art from the modern part of the collection of the Hermitage, which is the Winter Palace. Finally, I'll leave you with Carlo Rossi Street, named after the great architect. It is the famous street that you may have read about in St. Petersburg, which is a mirror image of itself. 220 meters long, 22 meters wide, with buildings 22 meters tall on each side. Conservatism, stability, profits, wealth, no excesses, Euclidean architecture, all of this is the capital into which the Middletons come, and you will see this sort of obsession with stability, wealth, and social status reflected in the portraiture of the time. So I hope that this very quick excursion gives you an idea of the period of time we're dealing with, and I'll let people who are much more qualified than I fill in the more fascinating parts of portraiture. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for that. And before I put on my curator cap, I will just say, make two more administrative remarks. And that is that I don't think I said this because of the distraction of things up here, but we are foregoing formal introductions this evening, just sort of in the spirit of trying to keep our focus on content and this very kind of tightly packed night. And when I said that we would all be joining, returning to the stage, I should have pointed out that Hillwood's curator of Russian art, Wilfried Zeisler, is going to be coming up in addition to the speakers who are standing at the podium this evening. He looks at me from the front row as if that is a surprise. It is not. All right, so with all of that context in mind, we will leap into the exhibition. I am going to skip my first slide, just not this one, because this one is just too good. But I will skip slide two and leap into the content of the exhibition itself. I'm going to step away from the light just because I'm going to ask you a question. How many of you have already seen the exhibition? And the other half of you need to see it still. All right, well, I will just sort of lay the groundwork, but rather than speaking to you from a podium on a stage, I'd much rather be speaking to you about this material in the presence of it in the gallery. So I hope that after we get finished in here that you will join us out there. And I will be joined by Wilfried and by Jenny Levy, curatorial associates here at the museum. So we have built an exhibition around a keepsake album. Here it is. Originally, it contained 45 watercolor portraits, sort of the who's who of 1820 St. Petersburg. So that in and of itself makes for an interesting object. We acquired this piece in 2004 from the descendants of Henry Middleton. And what we learned from them is that this is an album that their family assembled during their time posted to St. Petersburg from 1820 to 1830. So this is the object. Our challenge in creating an exhibition around it is, first off, we had to conserve the portraits, so we actually had to remove them from the album. They were adhered with a very acidic glue that over time would have destroyed the pieces. Lucky for us, we got them out. They're in very good condition, the 45 portraits, but they will forever live independent of one another, the book and then the 45 individual paintings. So here we are tasked with the challenge of creating a story with this material. We wanted to honor the bookness of the album, and we wanted to make sure that that we were able to show the individual portraits as the lively objects that they are. So instead of framing them, we wanted them to just float in air, and for you to be able to be with the pictures in the gallery sort of as if you were with them in the book platform, and you were moving through sort of the chapters that maybe you could have imagined if you had just been flipping through this keepsake album. So with that in mind, we set out to create some of these chapters. The first one, getting into the portraits themselves, and as I said, we don't go deep on this topic. What we have at sort of the base is that of the 45 portraits, we have two that are signed by Peter Sokolov, one of the, you know, the premier miniature portrait artists of the day. The other 43 are unsigned. There is family lore that has come to us with this album that Henry Middleton's eldest daughter, Maria Henrietta, may have had a hand in the creation of these pictures. So as Wilfred and I researched in preparation for the exhibition, as we looked at sort of the history and thought about ways we could sort of bring that history to life, we always kept an eye open to Wilfred in particular, to looking for evidence that substantiated this family lore. And as we went along, we found letters requesting that Maria Henrietta do portraits, evidence that she was trained by her tutor, who is well remembered for her skill as a miniature portrait painter. But unfortunately, at least at the time, we had to seal the books and put the pictures on the wall. We were not able to come up with a smoking gun that says, yes, indeed, Maria Henrietta is the hand behind the other portraits. There actually, there seem to be a couple of different styles at play, so it may be that we're looking at multiple hands. But in the exhibition gallery, you see that we get into that story a bit, and then just sort of dip into the tradition of miniature portrait painting and the tradition of copying portraits, but I think we're going to hear a little bit more about that later in the evening. So Middleton's diplomacy, I will not linger here because I think Anton really laid that story very nicely before us. But I will stop here for a moment because he did such a nice job of sort of ranging through the architecture of St. Petersburg as a city on the rise. What this exhibition has allowed us to do is to really make hay of some of the most delicious bits in our collection. We actually have a very sort of large body of pieces in our collection decorated with scenes of what St. Petersburg looked at the time the Middletons arrived in St. Petersburg. So all of those photographs that Anton showed you, many of them appear in painted form and engraved form on some very fine objects in our collection. So As you can imagine, for those of you who know Hillwood or just have a sense of it maybe from this evening, sometimes it's really hard to really focus on objects and the way they're decorated and the context of the house. So as staff here, we really delight in these opportunities to take things out of the collection and put them in a case under lights and really have an opportunity to pay close attention to all of the information that they contain. We're able to do a similar thing, looking at the figurative landscape against which Middleton worked. And again, Anton laid this path very nicely for us. It was a time of great change, and the way we're able to tell this story using our collection to illustrate this story that we're having you walk through is to look at a rather substantial holding of Napoleonic era glass in our collection, just to kind of mark that change from Napoleon rolling through and conquering all, leading to instability and sort of this new Congress system coming into place and assuring a longstanding peace going into the future. So we do that well. And another piece that I actually don't have in slides here, but there's a long string in the exhibition that looks at that 10-year period when Middleton was in St. Petersburg. As Anton said, he is the longest standing American minister to Russia, and I don't think many representatives have had an opportunity to enter under one emperor, to exit under another, to go through a funeral and everything that's involved in that, and a coronation and everything involved in that. And again, for those of you who know the Hillwood collection, you know that we have great strengths and sort of the decorative arts associated with many of Russia's rulers. So we were able to pair some of our holdings to help sort of tease out that rather extraordinary decade. And then in addition to our pieces, we actually loaned or were able to borrow some of Middleton Place Foundation. So the Middleton family's ancestral home is actually a museum and attraction just outside of Charleston, South Carolina. And they very generously loaned to us their very finest Russian things. So the last bit of the exhibition is at once, you know, a serious look at social history and a little bit of a romp through some very delightful years in fashion and sort of the theater of presentation, if you will. So some of the correspondence from the family's letters, from the family's papers rather, just painted these beautiful stories of what their life was like. So we were able to go from sort of having a general notion of the history of the period and using that as backdrop for our storytelling to going into some of the family's stories and using you know, their very personal details to help connect the people in the album to either pieces in our collection or in this case to a famous work of art. And this was a favorite sort of research moment of mine when Wilfred and I were in Charleston, South Carolina at the Historical Society of South Carolina, really trying to get a handle on, you know, the Middleton papers that were there, and then later at the Historical Society of Pennsylvania. And here I started reading this crazy cross-written letter that Mrs. Middleton, Henry Middleton's wife, wrote to their youngest children who they had to leave in England on their way to Russia for fear of disease, and they just heard bad stories on their way over and decided to play it safe, left the children with family in England. Thankfully, they did that because Mrs. Middleton religiously wrote to her children these beautiful letters that only a mother can write, describing in the greatest detail everything that they were up to that was fun and of interest. So we have those papers sort of in hand, and I was reading this one and all of a sudden I realized you have to sort of look for keywords when you encounter a letter like this to even see if it's going to be worth your while to, you know, go cross-eyed trying to get to the content of the document, and all of a sudden I started seeing the names of some of the sitters who we knew were, their portraits were part of the album. And I start reading out loud to Wilfred, and I said, oh my God, they were doing a tableau vivant. They, you know, the people who were in our album joined together, they posed as if a famous painting from history. And I start describing it. I'm like, it's a scene from Dido and Aeneas. And so I'm having this deeply 19th century experience. And Wilfred pulls out his smartphone and starts, you know, typing in and flips the phone around and says, they posed as this picture. So we had this kind of really great 19th to 21st century, you know, psychic commute there. And that was where our storytelling began, was with this one kind of putting these first puzzle pieces together. And then we just, at the end of things, just sort of delight in Romantic era fashions. And again, Anton did a great job setting this up. He mentions Marie Antoinette and sort of the audacious fashions of the 1770s, the dresses, the hair. And when you think about over the top fashion, you know, I think, you know, the mind immediately goes to the 1770s and on. You don't necessarily land in the 1820s, but when you look at the portraits on the album, you will see some people who look like they are characters extracted from a Jane Austen novel. They're wearing the, you know, the high-waisted empire style, very kind of simple, classical muslin day dresses. So you'll see a little bit of that, and a turban even here and there. But then as you continue to look through the portraits in the book, you are in the album now on the wall, you start to see the necklines go down, the shoulders go out, the waist comes in, the skirts go out, everything becomes bigger. And that happens for a number of reasons, but again, it tracks with literature of the day, because you see people putting down their Jane Austen and picking up Walter Scott, Mary Shelley. They really find themselves lured in by the overwrought emotion of this romantic period in literature. So all of a sudden, all those Jane Austen characters kind of go to the side, and you see all of these very full characters coming to the fore. And that is in dress, but it's also in hair. These are actual sitters from our album. This is a 21st century person dressed as these gals here, and I, you know, you, these people seem so far away and so long ago, but this piece for me just kind of brings it to the present a bit. You know, these days we have our own 21st century sort of gravity-defying hairdos that we see when we are out on the street. Thankfully, we have nice artificial products that we put on our hair these days, and it's no longer the animal fat scented with the citrus oils to cover the stench of the lard as it turns. But just sort of a little moment in history where sort of what goes around comes around, past as prologue. So we have a little good fun at the end of things looking at the fashion history, and I think I just have a few portraits tucked in here at the end, which perhaps is the best transition I can make into the focus of the evening, this talk about portraiture. The hair. And it's not just for the women. It's interesting, the men's hair actually tracks very closely to young men's hair of this very moment, where it's, you know, all about the pomades and making it look like you just hopped out of bed looking every bit as good as you do. Speak of the devil. We have someone who looks suspiciously like this on our very staff. So I think he's my last. And with that, that's just to sort of whet your appetites, and I will look forward to talking to you more about the exhibition, but in the gallery. I will stop and welcome Polly to the stage.
Thank you very much, Angie. Oh my, they were not joking about that dazzling light. You need sunglasses up here. My sincere thanks to Hillwood for the invitation to speak tonight, and especially to Erin for all of the logistical details. I don't think we should be talking about portraits at all. We should be talking about hair, and I'm going to compete that gentleman, the last one Angie showed. He's not a member of your staff. He is definitely one of my students at the moment. So we're here tonight to celebrate this remarkable exhibition, Friends and Fashion, which conjures up these intriguing social and professional worlds that an American diplomat and his family moved in at the interface of the reigns of Alexander I and Nicholas I. The watercolour portraits, which are at the heart of that exhibition, clearly didn't come from a vacuum. They come out of this vibrant tradition of Russian portraiture, which had been developing since the 18th century. And what I want to do tonight is look at signal moments in that progression and consider ways in which Russian portraitists drew on Western precedent. We can't get around that, but it's not being insulting, because at the same time they developed these very striking innovations of their own. Now, I start in the Imperial Academy of Arts, which is for me the heart of the Russian Empire. This is the building where I wasted my youth, basically. It is a phenomenal institution founded by Empress Elizabeth in 1757, given its first charter by Catherine the Great, who is invariably now credited as its foundress in histories. She's so good at that, isn't she? Taking the credit sometimes for stuff she really didn't do. But she gave it its first charter, and she also founded its first permanent home, and its current permanent home, which is what you're looking at now. I say I've wasted my youth in this building. It's a brilliant place to work because it is still one of Russia's most important art schools. It was Russia's most important art school for well over a century, which is an incredible achievement. And it's still one of the iconic places to study. So if you emerge, sort of blinking as I am up here, from the archive, you literally are sort of knocked over by art students running around with their portfolios. So it has an incredible sense of longevity and continuity. One of the more programmatic of Europe's art academies, it had its own boarding school, which at its most extreme admitted students at the age of 5 and dispatched them when they were 21. So you spent 16 years studying there, quite a long time. It also insisted that its teachers and its students wear uniform. And this changed as people moved through the various stages. So this is one of the more senior students depicted here. And I show you, too, a beautiful image of the central staircase inside the building, which I chose as the cover for my book because it speaks so eloquently of the role that the Academy played in educating Russia's artists and professionalizing the arts. There's a chance that this child on the... Sorry, wrong button. This little child on the stairs here. Can you see a little boy here? He's possibly one of the students in the academy. He's certainly the right age for it at this stage. And just to point out, he's staring intently at this oval-shaped frame, which is almost certainly a portrait. Oval frames tend to be portraits. Portraitists soon became the most numerous in the academy. It was the profession to which they most aspired, despite the fact that history painting was the most elevated pursuit. You wanted to be a portraitist because that's where the money was. And very soon we see this really intriguing generation of portraitists emerging. Now, foremost amongst them was this artist, Dmitry Levitsky, who is possibly the artist behind one of Hillwood's most iconic paintings, that massive full-length portrait of Catherine the Great. He was born the son of a priest in Kiev. He moved to St. Petersburg in the 1750s, and he did all sorts of... He carried on as an icon painter, which is how he'd been trained. He did various bits of decorative work, including triumphal arches for Catherine the Great's coronation. But in 1770, he finally made his mark in portraiture when he exhibited 8 paintings at the annual exhibition that year. And this included his portrait of Alexander Kakorinov, which really was his making. So who was Kakorinov? Kakorinov was himself one of the signal people working in the academy. He was an architect. He was the first Russian professor to teach in the academy. At this stage, they're still frantically importing French and German professors. He was the first man to teach in Russian in the academy, all of the other teaching being in French. And he'd served as the institution's inspector, rector, and director. So he was one of the more prominent figures there. On the back of these achievements, the Academy commissioned this portrait from Levitsky in 1769. Now, what we're looking at, this is a fabulous vanitas portrait. Karkorinov is wearing this extraordinary attire. Now, look at that. You don't get professors wearing that these days, and you didn't really get professors wearing that in those days, unless you were Karkorinov, who was this incredibly vain man. He had this is according to Sergei Diaghilev, who wrote a biography of Levitsky in the early 20th century, and Diaghilev writes that Karkorinov spent nearly a year's salary on this outfit, which was to celebrate the foundation of the Academy's new building. We see also his papers laid out on a stately French writing desk. Now, these intrigue me because Karkorinov was involved in the design and the building of that academy institution, which I just showed you. But there is a chance that his role has been dramatically overplayed. He worked alongside a Frenchman called Valin de la Motte, and there's a chance that Karkorinov actually was very much the sidekick rather than a central architect. I've had this from architectural historians based in Russia. And yet, Levitsky still shows him here, alongside the plans of the building, which if any of you have set foot in it, they're very distinctive because there's this enormous central circular courtyard. So what Levitsky is doing is very much giving Karkorinov some sort of ownership of this building. So we're conferring on the sitter in this portrait enormous professional achievement and social respectability, and Levitsky's status is enhanced as well. So by portraying a member of the Academy in such an elevated mode, he also gets his rewards. Lo and behold, he's made an academician for this work. Now, if Levitsky embodies the aims of the Academy, the very neoclassical training, Russian portraiture is also invigorated in this period by an incredibly different group of artists, and that is serfs, working absolutely on the edge of, if not outside, the artistic establishment. And exemplary here is Ivan Agunov, a serf all his life. At no stage did he acquire his freedom. He was a serf of the Sheremetyevs, who were one of the wealthiest, a spectacularly wealthy family in Imperial Russia. And he was one of legion serf artists, architects, craftsmen, ballerinas, dancers, actors, all the rest of it. This entire cultural industry belonging to the Sheremetyev family, which was entirely populated by serfs. There were, by the way, two architects and three painters in Agunov's family alone. So it was a very artistic milieu that he worked in. He was educated in the house of his uncle, a butler, in the Sheremetyev's elegant St. Petersburg residence. And then in the 1740s, he carried on to work with a German artist called Georg Grote, who had worked at the Russian court, was one of the very successful painters at the Russian court. This training included copying. And one of the things that Angie asked me very much to make clear is that copying was not seen then as some derivative, slightly hopeless pursuit you did that if you had no kind of decent ideas of your own. It was absolutely essential. It was an essential stage in the development of any artist. And if you think, I mean, that was true across the board in Europe, but in Russia, where there's such a strong icon tradition and where icon painters are not meant to be innovative, they're meant to constantly refine a revered formal prototype. So in Russia, the practice of copying had even more elevated status. So when we talk in the exhibition about copying, this is not something that we've got kind of, you know, second-rate artists dabbling with. It was very much part of what they did, and copies were very esteemed in their own right. So people would pay quite a lot of money to buy good copies. Well versed in the fashion of European portraiture, Agunov produced many portraits of the Sheremetyev clan, which happily emulated his French and German contemporaries. Here we've got the portrait of Boris Sheremetyev of 1775, so a quintessential aristocratic portrait of the period. More noteworthy, though, are works such as his little-known but remarkable portrait of the Kalmyk girl Anushka, which portrays a ward of Countess Varvara Sheremetyeva. In her hands, the girl holds a print portrait of the Countess, who had died that same year. So the painting encodes a very complex constellation of identities and relationships. At an obvious level, you've got a young girl who's paying tribute to a patron of much higher social standing who's recently died. And in this respect, what the painting does is it enables this respectful social and aesthetic experience. The deceased is honoured by the means of a portrait which brings to mind her significant deeds. But Anushka's identity here is very problematic, not least because the European style of dress and bonnet that she wears in her adoptive home denies her native heritage, and it sits particularly conspicuously against her darker skin. While her beauty and her corporality are forcefully present, accentuated by this vermilion gown with lace trim, the Countess is at three removes. So the Countess, who is the more sort of senior and elevated and revered figure in this particular encounter, is actually three removes from us. She is presented to us via a painting of a print of a painting. So the hierarchy of the relationship between the Countess and her ward is a very unsettled one. So the one is brought forward in this sort of forceful and very colourful way, the other recedes in monochromatic form. By contrast, nearly two decades later, Argunov focused on native rather than Western attire in his much more famous portrait of an unknown woman in Russian dress. Now, the painter at this point had been promoted to manage one of the Sheremetyev's residents in Moscow, and he had relatively little time to paint. He nonetheless moved on from his early encounters in very significant ways. Here, there's a growing authority to his painting, celebrating the ornate sarafan and the kokoshnik of his sitter with quiet aplomb. Now, his attentiveness to the detail of this outfit is matched by the surface richness of the canvas itself. I don't think we can talk about one without talking about the other. Colour is applied, for those of you who've seen this picture, and I suspect there are some in the audience who have, I know there are, colour's applied with a very loaded brush. So you get very sort of, you get an impasto effect in places. And at the same time, we get this constant sort of give and take from the artist. He's trying to fool us that this is an actual costume at the same time as he takes away that belief by leaving very visible the motions of his paint and his brush. With a pose that had long been typical in European portraiture, the painting, I would say, transcends nationhood, but its ethnographic specificity, the belted sarafan and the kokoshnik embroidered with this extraordinary metal thread, confers on the image an unmistakable Russian identity as well. For all his success as an artist, Argunov remained a serf all his life. On occasion, though, serf painters acquired their freedom and went on to establish incredibly successful independent careers. The paragon in this respect is Fyodor Rokotov, born in a village near Moscow to a family of serfs belonging to a prince, but acquiring his freedom at a young age. By his mid-20s, Rokotov had come to the attention of some of the great cultural power breakers in St. Petersburg. Mikhail Lomonosov, founder of Moscow University, entreated Ivan Shuvalov, in the portrait here, who was the founder of the Academy of Arts, to allow Rokotov to copy some particularly impressive paintings in the Empress's collection. So you've got this young serf on this astonishing career trajectory, which is itself enabling amazing social mobility. And this is one of the things I've been intrigued by in my research over the last few years, that being an artist set you, if you were good, it could set you on the most incredible upward social trajectory in ways which I don't think we've really appreciated before. Shuvalov not only enabled this access to paintings in the Empress's collection, but he also allowed Rokotov to study at the Academy and was soon securing very impressive commissions for him. So you can see here Rokotov painting Shuvalov in 1760, the year he began to study at the Academy of Arts. Now, such was his progress that he was soon winning commissions not only from Russia's elite families, but also at court. And he used these opportunities very adroitly to demonstrate his technical prowess. So can I draw your attention down here, to this down here, this astonishing sort of slate of foreshortening where you've got the ermine-trimmed mantle tumbling out of the picture frame in a really audacious artistic move. This showcasing of his skills paid off, because in 1763, Rokotov became the only Russian artist to be given the honour of painting Catherine the Great. And this, by the way, is the image which appears in miniature form on one of Hillwood's snuff boxes, currently on display, so something to look for after our talks tonight. The Emperor sat for Rokotov just once. One chance. But he produced such an accomplished profile view, what you see here, that the sketch was approved, and he went on to paint a full-length oil painting. Now, Rokotov's portrait of the Empress here displays none of the showy bravado of his mantle in the painting of Paul. The pose is regal, respectful. The column and curtain are standard framing devices in elite portraiture, and the scepter, orb, and double-headed eagle as the insignia of imperial authority are dutifully emphasized. So far, it's fully expected. But this full profile pose was very unusual, not just in Russia in this period, in the 18th century, but more generally in Europe at the time. And it lends gravitas to, let us remember, this very presumptuous German-born claimant to the Russian throne in just the second year of her rule. So look how well she's adapted to this new position. The exquisite brushwork of Catherine's coiffure, interlaced with the pearls, the ruffles of her sleeves, and the lushness of her vestments, also placed the portrait apart. This became one of the most celebrated images of Catherine, disseminated in print form, on ceramics, as we know, on snuff boxes just across the way, showing how an artist of serf origins could go on to produce one of the most widely disseminated images of the ruler of the land. So again, making my point, social mobility was very much for the taking if you were a talented artist. In enjoying successful and independent careers, Argunov and Rokotov were far from common among serf portraitists. Far more typical was the early life of Vasily Tropinin, whose career brings us to the period celebrated in the exhibition Friends and Fashion. In his early 20s, Tropinin was sent to St. Petersburg to learn the skills of confectionery and pastry making. He also found time to study at the Academy of Arts. But in one of the really harsh, I suspect some of you are wondering whether serfs could study at the Academy, at times they were allowed in, most of the time they weren't. But one of the really harsh conditions was that you were only allowed to study there if your master signed an affidavit saying that if you graduated with the top prize, he would give you your freedom. Right? And the reason for this is the Academy didn't want to invest huge amounts of time and money training serf artists, only to find that the moment they graduated, they had to go back to the master's estate. So that was the requirement. Now, needless to say, most serf owners didn't sign this piece of paper. They wanted them to come back and be nice decorators in their home. So this happened to Tropinin. He started training at the Academy. He was doing extremely well. And then his master decided, no, actually, I think I'll take you back to my Ukrainian estate, and there you're going to be a pastry maker again. So a very, very frustrating time. This went on for years and years and years. But Tropinin quietly behind the scenes carried on painting. And he produced landscapes, he produced portraits. He often had to portray the family and friends of his master. And in this example, quite a rare group portrait like this in Russian painting of the time, you can see the classical statue, Corinthian columns, and glimpses of a lush and managed landscape, which provides a sort of a visual oratory of elite gentrified land ownership at the time. The artist here is clearly alive to the gendering of different groups. So can you see these gloriously pompous men, dark in their suits, darkly dignified with their medals around their necks, the woman pale, and here we are, carrying out the typical accomplishments of polite young ladies at the time. I like the fact they're sort of connected by the dog. The dog as a domestic pet seems to provide the interlace between the two groups. More informally, Tropinin developed a strong line in the portrayal of children, culminating in this head of a boy, a portrait of his son of 1818, and possibly inspired by Jean-Baptiste Greuze's portrait of Pavel Stroganov, which is in the Hermitage. Tropinin here is sort of unleashed from the very stultifying conventions of child portraiture, which had obtained until this time. So we can see, just as the young Stroganov's shirt is unbuttoned here, so Tropinin's collar is left open. The side lighting and the highlights on the hair play on this luminescent skin and the very guilelessly averted gaze. In 1823, Trupinin finally acquired his freedom at the age of 47. The Academy elected him an academician the following year, again putting to rest this idea that the Academy didn't support serf artists. It did. From that point on, Trupinin focused on the portrayal of domestic labour, most famously, as I'm sure many of you recognise, in Lacemaker, which kind of collapses the difference between portraiture and genre painting, with its emphasis on the specialist equipment of her trade. Now, I love the fact Trupinin insists that we think of this. We can't get to the sitter without thinking about the paraphernalia of her occupation first. Just as effective are his later but lesser known works in a similar vein. This painting in Novgorod, The Sempstress, being to my mind the most beautiful among them. I went to see this a couple of years ago. Here the brushwork of the face is loose and dewy, the hazy elided contours of the female form only partially evoked, all of which is in stark contrast to the finicky exactitude of the still life. And of absolute brilliant skill here is the way in which Trupinin uses this unadulterated white paint here on the skein of strand of lace, here on the pincushion, which has got a sort of chased metal base, which is then clamped onto the side of the table, and then most sort of virtuosic of all, this single line of white paint, which takes it down to the needle in her hand. This is superlative painting. Trupinin continued to intersperse a thriving portrait practice in Moscow with single-figure genre scenes in which he explored the properties of his materials, the properties of his paint, in ever more adventurous ways. Here in Peasant Whittling a Crutch, a bolder, more painterly method creeps in. The downcast eyes formed by a scumble of indecipherable marks, which only resolve into furrowed brow, bushy eyebrows, and a focused gaze once a suitable distance between the canvas and the viewer is restored. This is proto-impressionist. The background is left plain, and the scant differentiation in the contours, folds, and textures of the heavy brown coat as paint is applied with a much more lively, less cautious brush than had been the case with Lacemaker. Portraits such as these, by the way, in passing, are very much in step with the porcelain figures which the Imperial Porcelain Factory was making at the time, especially in the 1820s, very popular, and which are beautifully represented in Hillwood's collection, where you've got these porcelain figures celebrating different ethnic types, specifically Russian types, carrying out everyday activities in their various different forms of attire. And this was a rich vein which Trupinin was mining as well. And he celebrates his hard-won success in 1846. This, a man born a serf for decades, who'd been made to cut pastry for years and years and years on his master's estate. Finally, he's a free man and celebrating his new status in the city of Moscow, which he chooses to include very prominently with the Kremlin in the background. The second quarter of the 19th century was nonetheless troubled for the Academy and for Russia's artists, as Nicholas I, here in the famous portrait by Kruger, which is copied, of which there's a copy in Hillwood, and Nicholas of Tours, of course, took a very active and heavy-handed role in the cultural sphere. Now, people often think of his personal involvement in censoring Pushkin's work. That's one of the sort of totemic instances of this. But he was equally interventionist in the artistic world. He decides to take personal control of the Academy, and he transforms it into a sort of an organ of the state, which is meant to churn out paintings that will fit his taste. Now, kind of all well and good if you've got a Tsar in place with reasonably diverse and Catholic and interesting tastes. What Nicholas loved was paintings of soldiers. So what Nicholas got was paintings of soldiers. And sometimes, I love this, sometimes by adding soldiers to paintings by other artists, including some really brilliant old masters. So there is in the Hermitage one of the more curious exhibits is a painting by Jan van Goyen, the Dutch 17th century artist, with little tiny soldiers added by Nicholas I. He got very, very cross if you got military uniforms wrong, so you could lose your job as, say, a professor at the academy, if you had a military coat buttoned up the wrong way. I'm not making this up. He would have you dismissed. So being an artist in the reign of Nicholas I was not straightforward. Many artists, Ariest Kiprensky among them, dealt with this by travelling abroad and staying abroad for as long as they could. In Kiprensky's case, for 7 years. In Alexander Ivanov's case, who I'm not showing you tonight, for 28 years. That's a different story. But one of the ways in which they could flourish as artists was to put as much distance as they possibly could between their artistic practice and Nicholas's court. Kiprensky, another surf artist, studied at the academy. He confirmed his reputation with this extraordinary portrait of Pushkin in 1827. Now, by the time of this commission, Pushkin was little short of a household name. The most inventive and lyrical poet yet to work in the Russian language, he'd fallen foul of the authorities for his trenchant political views, and he'd been exiled from the capital for several years, most recently to his mother's estate. That was near Pskov, so relatively close to St. Petersburg. Now, Pushkin appealed directly to the Tsar, to Nicholas I, to be allowed back into the capital. And that was allowed, but the Tsar and his chief of police kept a very keen and close eye on him to make sure he didn't misbehave. So his activities, his movements, his creativity was strictly controlled. Despite these restrictions, Pushkin had acquired a huge following by 1827, by this year. For his poems, most recently for his fabulous novel in verse, Eugene Onegin, which was serialized from 1825. So think about it. Kiprensky is being asked here to portray Russia's most famous poet, and let's face it, the Russians are good at their poetry, who recently returned from exile, had demonstrated the true potential of the Russian language, given voice to political concerns, and was firmly in the censor's sights. My point is, this is not a commission for the faint-hearted. You need to get it right, which Kiprensky does. He rises to the challenge with this masterful work. It avoids, and I'm quite interested in this, as many of you know, Pushkin was very, very proud of his noble Ethiopian ancestry. But Kiprensky, I think, consciously pushes away from that for reasons we don't yet know. Nonetheless, this painting was seen straight away, not least by Pushkin's father, as the most brilliant likeness of the artist. And it's now seen as one of the quintessential works of Russian Romanticism. So he's got his folded arms, his fashionably tousled hair. Here we have more on hair. I think it is the theme of the night. He's gazing to his left with his tartan scarf, offering a possible allusion to Walter Scott and to Scottish Romanticism, which was very popular in St. Petersburg at the time. Behind him stands a statue of one of the Muses, the Greek goddesses of learning and the creative arts, who so often functioned as an attribute of male artistic force. But Kiprensky avoids a stereotype of the struggling writer. This is not a struggling writer. In contrast to Tropinin's version, painted the same year, where the poet appears with creased collar and fraying scarf, Pushkin is shown in contrast to Tropinin's version, where he's slightly dishevelled, Kiprensky's version has pristine collar tips, immaculately manicured nails. He's arrestingly stylish. I know, they're a bit horrid, aren't they? I did wonder about including that slide. Something a bit nasty about Pushkin's nails, but there we go. He's arrestingly stylish, groomed, and self-contained. I see myself as if in a mirror, but this mirror flatters me, he wrote. The palette is notable for its subtlety and restraint, the brown and olive tones, interrupted only by the flashes of white shirt, the highlights of the face, the rhythmic red checks. At the same time, the lack of eye contact between the sitter and the artist, and of course, therefore, between the sitter and the viewer, pushes us against any sense of complicity with the sitter in this case. The intimation of thoughts removed, which is brought about by the way in which Pushkin looks out of the portrait, was seized on by Kiprensky and Pushkin's contemporaries. They saw in the portrait an invocation of Pushkin's uniqueness, his rare talent ensconced in an interior world. Kiprensky's life was not without scandal, actually pretty horrid scandal. In 1822, Kiprensky had returned very precipitously from Italy, and his rapid departure was probably the result of some pretty horrid rumours circulating which is that there'd been a horrific fire in his studio, and his model cum mistress had died in that fire, and there were rumours circulating that he'd set the studio on fire on purpose with that aim in mind, because he was engaged in inappropriate relations with her daughter. Now, if that wasn't bad enough, the year after this portrait, he returns to Italy and he gets married to a woman who was thought to be that same daughter of his earlier lover who died in the studio fire. This is not a particularly pleasant narrative. Unsurprisingly, Kiprensky's cachet with elite sitters quickly waned. Instead, it was Karl Brulov who ruled the roost as Russia's premier society portraitist in the reign of Nicholas I. Now, Brulov was part of this big artistic family who make intermittent appearances in the exhibition Friends and Fashion. He was the brother of Alexander, and there are copies of works by Alexander related to the exhibition. He was also the brother of Yulia, who married Pyotr Sokolov, Sokolov being the artist who has signed two of the watercolours in the album. So we've got Karl Brulov floating in a slightly sort of disembodied way around the edge of the exhibition. But it was Karl who became the standout star of the Brulov family, indeed the most successful Russian painter of his generation, for his undisputed masterwork, The Last Day of Pompeii. Now, his sources for this massive, fraught painting were eclectic and imaginative. He visited Pompeii in 1827, when archaeological excavations were in full swing, and he was so struck by what remained of the Via dei Sepolcri that he determined to set his painting there. He also spent time in the Museum of Naples, studying pottery, kitchen utensils, and other artifacts which had been unearthed at Pompeii. And then there's a strong classical rationale to his pictorial decisions. The scene of the elderly woman here, the elderly woman here imploring her son to leave comes directly from Pliny the Younger's account of the tragedy of the eruption of Vesuvius and the immolation of Pompeii, and poses are derived from those of Greek and Roman sculpture, or iterations of these in Italian painting of the 16th and 17th centuries. But matched with those neoclassical references and debts is the way in which Brulov enacts romantic predilections at the time. In this we see this in the extraordinary ambition of the painting, the melodrama of the toppling statues, the torsion of the bodies, the Burkean sense of the sublime. The composure and modelling of neoclassical history painting is accordingly exploded in The Last Day of Pompeii in favour of movement and spatial recession, with the bolting horse here dragging a man who's got a foot stuck, an absolutely brilliant a tour de force of foreshortening. The colouring was likened to an omelette by a contemporary. We're not entirely sure that that was a compliment. It's nonetheless vibrant and unrestrained. And presiding over the entire thing was this great romantic topos of the artist himself present here with Brulov supporting his box of artistic tools and standing witness to the event. Such was the impact of The Last Day of Pompeii, not to mention its international stature, that it became a national cultural icon from the moment it arrived back in Russia in 1834. It was painted in Italy. But the composition and pictorial strategies that underpinned its success eluded Brulov in his later years, almost all of his history paintings from this point on remaining incomplete. Instead, it was portraits of Russia's social and intellectual elite, the imperial family among them, that enabled him to fashion a public identity of unprecedented power and ensured that his fame didn't rest on one painting alone. Now, portraits of women are particularly significant in Brulov's oeuvre, this one of the Lady Rider of 1832 being a famous example, though I have to say viewers have long been slightly perturbed by this imperturbable, well, we've been perturbed by her imperturbability, astride her frankly alarming horse. An immeasurably more successful work, and I'm not just flattering my hosts here, is of course Hillwood's portrait of the Countess Yulia Samoylova, which was painted, or whose painting overlapped with that of The Last Day of Pompeii. Samoylova was a bit of a naughty woman. She was incredibly wealthy, but an improvident spendthrift, legendary for her love affairs, who'd become something of a pariah in St. Petersburg. It's said that Nicholas I threatened any army officers who were caught going to her parties with demotion to the Navy. That was how bad they were. And that's how shocking that threat was. So in 1827, she was pretty much obliged to leave Russia, and she instead took up residence in a truly spectacular villa on Lake Como near Milan, where she entertained a glittering array of creative talent. The writers Turgenev and Balzac, the composers Rossini, Donizetti and Verdi, most notably Giovanni Pacini, with whom she had a long affair. So in short, she was this powerfully alluring person who was entirely untroubled by social mores or financial constraints. Brulov was drawn to her flame, absolutely. He struck up an intimate acquaintance with her. He used her as a model for The Last Day of Pompeii. And in this portrait, he explores with great panache the ways in which her fortune and breeding rub alongside her refusal to conform. In the first place, so the way in which he shows her stature and her noble status is quite evident. We've got, obviously, the luxuriousness of her attire. At the moment, I do think quite brilliantly reenacted in that paper sculpture by a contemporary artist just next door. We've got the family crest there over the door. We've got her ward, which was a common practice amongst aristocratic women at the time. And then we've got her black page, who is deftly juggling these extraordinary sort of cashmere shawls that she's leaving behind her. These are all offset by the red velvet drape, a favoured backdrop in noble portraits, which highlights the wealth and the standing of Samoylova to great effect. But there are intimations of her transgression as well. This coquettish skip to the Countess's step, do you walk like that through your sitting room? I certainly don't. A beguiling tilt to her head, the spaniel in the foreground who threatens to tear this beautiful lace. Now, dogs, yes, they denote loyalty and fidelity, but they can act as symbols of promiscuity and carnal desire as well. So the result is a very provocative painting, a very complicated painting, which showcases Brulov's abilities, yet also alludes to Samoylova's unconventional behaviour that, like that of the artist, deviated from conventional social norms. Brulov would paint Samoylova again. In this painting, 10 years later, of her and her ward, Amitsalia Pacini, leaving the ball. Here, the statuesque unorthodoxy of the Countess is again evoked, in this case through a cacophonous patchwork of fabrics against a much sketchier background. He also used more conscious use of unfinished passages in his self-portrait of 1848, a beautifully understated painting in which there are glimpses of bare canvas through the diagonal brushstrokes at the top, echoing the lines of the chair and the fingers of this iconic artist, who was, by the way, by now a very sick man. With its dynamic execution and sudden moments of impasto, this is a portrait of subtlety and intelligence, revealing the influence of Velázquez, who Brulov very much admired. The Russian portrait tradition continued to soar in the decades that followed, not least in the work of its remarkable realist artists, the Передвижники. This included Nikolai Gay's absorbing portrait of Leo Tolstoy, whose craggy features and colossal reputation drew artists like moths to a flame. It included Rapin's portrait of Mussorgsky and Pierov's portrait of Dostoevsky, the portrait of Dostoevsky, the only portrait of this writer that was painted from life. Incidentally, for those of you who don't know, Mussorgsky by this stage was ravaged by alcohol and had been hospitalized, and Rapin hastened by train, overnight train, from Moscow to St. Petersburg to paint him in his hospital bed. So he's actually in the dressing gown that he wore when he was in hospital. By a sort of remarkable coincidence, Rapin arrives to start this portrait on the 2nd of March, 1881, which is the day after the assassination of Tsar Alexander II. And Rapin writes how the two of them sat, sort of mired in this portrait encounter for 3 days, talking of nothing but the shocking event, the murder of the Tsar. And Rapin left after 3 days, hoping to return for a final sitting for the portrait, but Mussorgsky died 10 days later, so it remained in the state it was at. And I think this brilliantly encapsulates the energy of these inter-art encounters in Russia in this period. There were mesmerizing portraits of women as well. Indulge me for a moment as I show you two of the showcase pieces from an exhibition of Russian portraits that we did at the National Portrait Gallery in London last year. So you can see Anna Akhmatova on the right, a painting by a brilliant and undersung woman artist called Olga Delavoskardovskaya, and our unforgettable poster girl, the Baroness Ixkel von Hildenbrandt by Rapin on the left. She caused me enormous grief. I know you all like to hear the behind-the-scenes tales of these exhibitions. She caused me huge grief when she arrived because her designated spot was over an air vent, and the Russian couriers who brought her to London took one look at this air vent and they just said, we're definitely not hanging the Baroness over an air vent. So we spent an entire afternoon pulling our hair out and in great consternation. And then some bright spark had the probably quite obvious idea of simply covering the air vent, which is what we did. And to my delight, when Fraser, the gallery handyman, arrived to carry out this task, he was dressed for the event. Look at that. What are the chances? These various paintings confirm beyond doubt the presence of a rich and robust Russian school of portraiture that continued to intersect with other cultural practices, but projected a thrilling sense of its own identity as well. In the years that followed, the expectations and ambitions of Russian portraitists would change beyond recognition. A new generation, headed first by Rapin and then by Valentin Serov, would develop a rich form of Russian impressionism. Mikhail Vrubel would propel a new symbolist movement and experiment with the fragmentation of volumes into faceted planes in a way that anticipated cubism by more than a decade. These developments would push further and further away from figuration and mimesis, paving the way for the iconoclasm of the avant-garde. These avant-garde artists would stick their heads higher and higher above the parapet and dazzle global audiences as never before. But they stood on the shoulders of their predecessors, who had doggedly promoted and developed the capability of Russian artists and developed a web of complex and creative portrait traditions that Russia could proudly call her own. Thank you very much.
By the light. Well, thank you so much. We have about 10 minutes, and I think we will jump right into questions because you've all been waiting very patiently. And there was so much material to talk about, right? I mean, so would anyone like to start us off with a question for one of our lecturers here?
Somebody in the back.
Oh, there you are, in the back. Yes.
So I was
It is indeed. Yes.
And one of the descendants is a major donor to the Hillwood Museum as well and lives in town.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. Any other questions? Yes.
When you were studying in Russia, what language did the students and the faculty use?
When I was there, Russian. Yeah, Russian. The question was when I was studying, what language did the students and the faculty use? It was Russian, but so the first decades of the academy, the students were all taught in French, apart from rarely Kokorinov, who taught in Russian. And then, so French was part of their curriculum. Again, this extraordinary thing that you could get students from pretty lowly social backgrounds suddenly getting training in French and in geography and history and all sorts of, you know, in geometry. And then they introduced German and Italian just at the turn of the 18th, 19th century. But by that stage, actually, Russian had become the common language of instruction, and that's how it stayed.
Yes, in the back.
So I know in the Russian Council of History, so we started with Peter the Great, so it was a big influence of Dutch, French, and after German scientists, they were invited professors. So how long the European culture and science was influenced in Russia, and when actually the Russian
bothered the kind of the trailblazers for the Academy of Arts. One of the reasons that institution was founded is there was huge frustration at how German-centric the Academy of Sciences was in the 18th century. So it was dominated by this sort of cabal of German scientists and scholars and all the rest of it, who were felt very much to promote the interests of their own national group. Yeah, and Lomonosov exactly was very sort of frustrated about this. So the Academy of Arts liked to set it up as this new, very sort of ethnocentric, very Russian motivated institution. The problem was when it came to employ professors, there weren't Russian artists of a sufficient caliber, or at least they felt there weren't Russian artists of a sufficient caliber to employ as professors. So they had to carry on importing French and German artists in the early years. But by the 1780s, certainly by the 1790s, there was a sense that once you'd got artists like Lysenko, the history painter who was the history professor there, as the history painting professor, once you'd got them coming to the fore, the Academy tried very much to, I mean almost consciously from that point, tried to exclude foreigners from its staff. Because they had these absurd situations where you had foreigners on the staff who didn't necessarily speak Russian, and so for all that the students were being taught their language, they couldn't converse and communicate properly. And the Academy's papers are all in Russian. So you sometimes had, at one point you had a director of the Academy who didn't speak any Russian at all. So all of the documents that the Academy produced about its statutes and its bylaws and everything had to be translated into French for this one man to read. So it became a bit absurd. And certainly by 1800, it was pretty sort of Russia-centric.
Yes.
I've got a question perhaps for Wilfred and Andrew about the conservation of the Middleton portraits. If they've been taken out of the album, presumably, in which they've been protected from light after all this time, they've been preserved, you've removed them from the acid-bearing paper and so on. Are they going to be able to remain on display, or are you going to have to put them away and keep them out of the light for most of the time? How are they going to display?
Well, we'd very much like to bring the exhibition to a Charleston, South Carolina artist, so we have a desire to travel the exhibition, but because they are works on paper, we will have to be careful about how we care for them, of course, with regard to light and whatnot. But because you mentioned the conservation, I will share my other favorite story about our adventures and research, where Wilfred and I were sitting up at the Historical Society of Pennsylvania, and we had not left ourselves enough time to go through the boxes and boxes and boxes of Middleton family papers there. And I think we had pushed about an hour or so past our prime, and he was going through, I think it was some Maria Henrietta letters, finding that evidence to substantiate that family idea that she had had a hand in the creation of some of the pictures. And he's just very respectfully brandishing one of the letters in the air a little bit, very respectfully.
I guess.
Recognizing the, you know, and he does like this, and he has one of those library lamps behind him. And, you know, we had just gotten the conservation photography back that had revealed some of the watermarks in the paper that were complete with the maker and the date. And because I was sitting there kind of laughing at him, being sort of a little punch drunk. Yes, you were. I could see the watermark in the paper. And so, you know, again, no smoking gun, but Maria Henrietta's writing letters on the same paper that's used for the for the portraits. So it was sort of a ha-ha moment. And as you all know, those of you who have conducted historical research, there are things that you find that you go out looking for, and then there are the things that just sort of present themselves to you in the course of research.
And actually, it turned out that some of the Sokolov works in Russia actually are on the same paper from the same period, so nice connections.
Mm-hmm. Yes, ma'am.
Question to that. The letter that's written this way, mm-hmm. you read it to the bottom this way and then go this way, or which way do you do it?
Yeah, I mean, read.
The conversation just mm-hmm. turns, and then you go the other way.
Yeah.
They're a delight. And I have that letter that I will take out to the gallery, so if you would like to see it.
A photo of it.
Absolutely. I am as respectful of the historical documents as Wilfred is.
Yes,
go.
Sure.
For
you.
You are curriculum.
Yes.
Do you have curriculum at the university? Your emphasis evidently is on history.
Yes.
But the curricula, did you do, are you an artist also, or are you just?
No, I'm an art historian. So I teach in Cambridge University. I'm a university professor. I teach across the board in the 18th and 19th century. So I teach sort of French and German and British as well, but I specialize in Russia.
Right, but no, but back to the curriculum. For your rounding of education,
yes.
You never had to take any art courses or anything.
Did I have to take any?
Or
certainly
just
not at
art history.
I did at school, not at university. But I didn't. I studied languages first. I was at university, and then I became an art historian a bit later.
And I'm sure you didn't have to wear a uniform.
No. Thankfully not.
Any other questions?
I have a question
yes.
about language. Mr. Middleton, do you speak Russian? Do you speak French? How did he communicate? And also, where was he in the pecking order of the court? I mean, America was a very young, second-rate mm-hmm. nation, so did he have access to the Tsar? Was he a big deal or a small deal?
A Middleton deal. He was at the... let me break that down. He spoke French fluently, which was another of his qualifications for this posting. French would have been, I will say, the language at court. It's interesting, though, when you look through their papers, because they received invitations to things in Russian Cyrillic and French and English. Which gives a sense of just sort of all of the languages you would have heard at court. Give me your other question again. I'm a horrible rememberer.
Where was the United States?
We were a minister at the court, so we did not have an embassy. We did not have an ambassador until almost the very end of the 19th century. And I just looked that up the other day, and now it escapes me under what president or under what circumstances that happened. But it's interesting, because one of the objects that we were not able to include in the exhibition is a Nicholas I coronation album that we have in our collection here at Hillwood. And that speaks a little bit to his standing. In Russia, there, Wilfred pointed out to me that there's a page, and make sure that I get this right, there's a page that lists the donors who funded the publication of the album, and Middleton is included there. His name also appears on a rather short list of the foreign officials who participated in the coronation festivities. And we actually have those folks sort of, many of those, his sort of peer level diplomats. Portraits are included in this album, and we've got them all hanging together in the gallery. So, you know, it's interesting when you, another primary source for us was the Middleton's second daughter's social diary, where she was as good a record keeper as her mother, and just sort of capturing all the the facts and whatnot of their time in Russia. And it's just interesting. You know, I highlighted the transcript of the journal, just kind of outlining when other sitters' names appear in it. And, you know, while we weren't, you know, we didn't have, you know, full diplomatic privilege or the highest diplomatic privilege, we certainly were in the, Middleton certainly was in the mix. You know, the ones whose names appear just over and over and over again would have been two of the highest ranking officials at court, the British minister, the British ambassador, and the French ambassador. Maybe it was by position, maybe their children were the same age, maybe the wives got along. You never know why something is, but their lives were very clearly and consistently intertwined.
I saw Mary Bailey's portrait. What was her connection to?
Just part of the British delegation there. You know, we know her husband was posted to the embassy. Jenny, I mean, did you do her biography?
Yeah.
Do you remember? It's been a long time, I know. I think we just say that she was generally part of, because we don't have her husband's portrait on the album, I think it did not.
Well, I was just curious, is this the middle, because my last name is Bailey. I'm from South Carolina. But needless to say, I was just curious whether it came out of South Carolina. Well, they all came
British.
Out of England.
British.
You understand what I'm saying?
Absolutely part of the British contingent there.
Oh,
okay.
Yes, sir.
I just have a clarification question. You said that some of the paintings may have been done by Henrietta, I think is her name, because of that you discovered the watermark on the stationery or on the paper. But on one of the letters that she did. My question is, though, it was also mentioned that Sokurov used paper that had the same watermark. So wouldn't that, in a sense, lessen the argument that
No, but the watermark, like discovery, was more about, it was a sort of most popular paper at the same time. So the family will use the paper for their like correspondence, and the artist at the same time will use the same paper, but it was a very popular paper in the Western world at that time. So it's not because of the watermark that we make the connection between Maria Henrietta as a possible author of some of the portrait. It's just because it was like, it's known that she was trained as an artist, that she did a lot of portraits, and through the correspondence we read, many of her friends actually asked her to make copies after portraits of her family she had done, or about portraits of someone from their relatives. So that's why we think that she may have copied many of the portraits which are now in our album. And also we have like some stories from the family that actually the granddaughter, who at one point of Maria Henrietta, who owned the album, said that she knew from her granddaughter that some of the portraits, she wrote that on a letter, but it doesn't mean it was the truth, but actually that her grandmother did some of the portraits. And actually there are a few of these, definitely there are two signed portraits by Sokolov, and then there are like two or three different hands, I will say, about the different other portraits. So, meaning I think that some of the portraits may have been done by Maria Henrietta, especially the one which are like more Russian looking, I will say, because we know she was mostly trained as an artist in Russia at that time, so it would make sense. And the other one may have been portraits that actually were given to her or given to the member of the Middleton family by their friends to be gathered and to be kept as souvenirs from their friends. So that's how I see the whole story about the portrait. But the problem is we know that Maria Henrietta was trained as an artist, that she was a great portraitist, but we don't have any signed work by her. So it's kind of like difficult to compare what we have with the work by her. So that just has to stay as a like question mark. So
yeah, and the watermark in the paper was really more fun and incidental than anything else. We've also had the question, you know, we had a hard time dating the pictures because, you know, we guess that they were created in the time that the Middletons were in Russia, but because they kept in contact with so many of the friends they made there for 10 and 15 years following their time together, you know, we also wondered, could these have been, you know, later copies of earlier pictures? And so, you know, again, if you get an 1827 watermark on a paper, it doesn't tell you that that picture was painted in 1827, but it kind of, you know, draws you into their time of residence and makes you think a little bit more seriously about that, unless, you know, did she paint it in 1834 after the fact, which sometimes can change the, you know, the character of a picture or the... It's also, there are inscriptions under lots of the names, and sometimes the people are called...
They
were married afterwards.
So it's how we created the datation for the portraits, because, I mean, the watermark is one thing, but then you had, like, the information about the people and about the time when they were in Russia, and some of the diplomats actually were in Russia that are featured in the album only like a few years, so you know that actually they would have met with the Middleton only during this period, so it's most likely the period when the portrait was made.
Okay, well, we've heard a great deal about Polly's book, and it's time to go and buy a copy. And we've also heard a lot about the exhibit, and it's time to go and look at the exhibit. So thank you all for coming, and just thank our speakers.